So what is the sort of step-by-step process that you're doing that gets you a great sound in the studio? Is there an order? Is it drums first, bass first?
Or? 95% of the time it's drums first. Right. Sometimes it's...
Why?
I don't know. It just seems to be the way that you know, I've fallen into, and you know, the sound engineers do. So, you know, it's nice to get some guide stuff down, you know, like guide guitar, guide bass, or everybody do it together, but just concentrate on the drums. But getting a sound after that, I think, is where I get my sound. And, you know, getting a nice drum sound, and then just going to town on it in the computer. I have no idea how to explain how I get my sound. I just keep messing around with tools until I like you know what comes out of the speakers.
It's probably you probably don't realise what you're doing that's so good. I'd imagine a lot of it's in the ears, isn't it?
Yeah, well, yeah, everything. I mean, obviously you can see it, so it makes things a bit easier for you know, correcting things, which some people do have a problem with. Oh, don't move this, don't move that, don't tune this, don't do that. Technology's there to help. You know, you know, as I said time and time again to many people, if you feel like that, give me your mobile phone and I'll put it in the bin, and you just go back to a landline. Oh no, but this is easier. Well, that's the same with this. You know, it's designed to make it easier. Yeah, but if you can't sing, you can be tuned. Yeah, you can, but you sound like a robot. So if you can't sing, don't sing. You know, it's, if you want to use it as an effect, then that's fine. But you know, it still sounds wicked. People want to use it. It's fine. And people want to cut drums up and put them in time. I love doing that. You know, people want to be perfect. The ear's used to it now. Put on the radio, you don't hear one thing out of place. Put a record on from the 80s, 70s, 60s, 50s, you know, and some 90s records, you know, there's fluctuations in... They're human, aren't they? Mm. But you know, that seems to have just kind of been brushed out.
So what do you think when you listen to, say... Somebody will say, this is a psychedelic masterpiece from the 60s, the holy grail of music making, might even be Sergeant Pepper. Mm. And the vocals are down one speaker and the instruments are on the other. Does that annoy you or...
It annoy me that
the fact that it's so imperfect to today's standards.
No, because at the time that was the best that... And everything was so new. That's why things were off in different places, because, wow, we got two speakers now instead of one. Let's stick the drums over there. You know, but I think I have no time for that sound at all. But at the time, it's revolutionary, so it was the best that you could do. So, of course, it was the best at the time. You know, it's made... If it wasn't for that kind of process, we wouldn't be sat here with our computers.
Yeah, they want to know what the process is like. So you've recorded all these great, but then must come the mixing, and I don't even know what mastering is and things. So do you want to talk, sort of go, okay, once you've got this in, then we do this, then we do that, and that's the magic.
Mm. Yeah, obviously, yeah. So you've got the drums, the bass, guitars. Let's say we do it in that order. Drums, bass, guitars, vocals. Let's say that's the order of bands. Keyboards, if there are any. Kind of the glitter on the top, you know, the kind of the filling of space or whatever, and then you know your reverbs or your echoes or your EQs, remove a lot of stuff that gets in things way, because obviously some instruments cross each other's, you know, space in the mix, and you know, you kind of just remove things so they kind of sit more evenly, and that's mixing. And then when you're happy with all those things together, you then treat the whole thing as one, so you're just left with one piece of audio, and that's mastering, where you can obviously make it a lot louder, which people seem to think is the best thing ever, which isn't. You know, let's just make it really loud, you know, because you know, you can only get so many people in the room, but if you overflow, some people's going to spill out and, you know, fall over and get hurt. And that's what's happening to the audio that's going, you know, too far through, you know, the mastering process. You can overcook it. You put Radio 1 on and it goes in your face. That's because it's been slammed through, you know, high mastering limiters and stuff, which make it really in your face. But you lose all the dynamics. If the drummer's got a nice easy fill and he's built up, it's all gone, because, you know, so mastering, you can, you know, ruin your cake, or you can make it, put the icing on and make it amazing. And that's the hardest thing. There are people that just do mastering, there are people that just do mixing and recording and producing. I've kind of had to learn to do everything, for the sense of I was the only person doing it when I started, and I didn't know anyone else. So I've kind of just learned and learned and learned and learned and learned. And some bands take their music off to be mastered somewhere else, you know, to have someone's fresh ear bring something to the table, or mixing and whatever, and that's cool. But yeah, mastering is just the sense of taking what you've done and just treating it as one to make it, you know, brighter, or, you know, something. Everything sounds different on these speakers, headphones, the boombox, your car stereo, your iPod. So you kind of just have to maybe find that sweet ground for that suits most things.
What is the out of all those sort of sound systems, which is the best one that you would go, if it sounds good on them, it's likely to sound pretty good on the others?
I think in the car.
In the car?
Yeah, because on an iPod speakers, you know, 95% of the chance it's an MP3, so you've lost, you may as well just give up because it's an MP3. You've lost all the quality, even if it's high end, it's just pointless. You know, why spend all that money recording it when it's going, you know, thousands of pounds worth of gear down to tiny iPod earphones, which have no real quality at all. You know, and then you go in the car, it's pretty much, you know, it's even playing field. You know, you lay your car, you have a drive, and it feels good. You know your settings, you know what you like. Put a few other CDs on. Oh, yeah, that sounds really good alongside those. Because you could be tricked, you know, obviously on big studio speakers. Oh, yeah, that sounds bloody good, that. Get in the car. Kind of get misled. But over the years, I've learned what doesn't work for me in those environments. But the car is definitely the test, I think.
Yeah, audio quality is something that seems to be going backwards in my mind. It used to be really important for a music fan at one point to go and get as good equipment as you possibly could to hear it.
Yeah.
Now it doesn't seem to matter as much.
It's crazy.
Seems odd that it feels like technology, not the technology is going backwards, but the demand for quality is going backwards.
Yeah, because I've got an iPhone, but I've never put any songs on it. Because I think, unless they're high res CD, exact CD audio, I'm not interested, because it's like going to, I've said this before, it's like going to a fish and chip shop, buying a £10 cod and chips, best in the country, going home and shoving it through your letterbox, closed, trying to ram it in, you know, and it comes out the other side all mashed up. Still fish and chips, but that's an MP3 to me. So it is crazy that, you know, oh, let's get 10,000 songs on my iPod. You know, I'd rather have 500 and they all be amazing quality, because it is bad for your ears, for artificial high end that the MP3s have. It absolutely bemuses me what bands spend X amount of pounds in a studio to go, yeah, just shove it on SoundCloud at any resolution will do, but over my head.
I've got the finished product, it's been well recorded, it's been beautifully mixed, and then you've just gone, let's make it a bit brighter or a bit more warmth or whatever.
Sure.
Then you must go, okay, we've done that for all the tracks, and then you must have to master the album to make it sound like a coherent
album. Yeah, so you've got, yeah, what I mean, there's obviously many ways of doing it. What I do is I take the loudest song, you know, the biggest song and the quietest song, and I do those two first, and then you just compare the others, A/B them as you go, solo, you know, oh, okay, it's the same volume, that one's got too much bass in it, oh, it's a slower song, so, you know, just do little changes to the low end and stuff. So you just do, obviously, the biggest and the smallest, and then just compare as you go to the rest of it. Then running order is the last thing, you know, where tracks might, if I want one fading into another and that kind of thing, that's the like kind of last stages. But that's you know, more after all the processing is done. That's just more just aligning tracks in an order. But yeah, I it's a sense of just getting, let's say, the biggest and the smallest sounding what you think is right. Compare it to a few commercial songs that have the same kind of feel. Then just make sure the rest of the tracks in the album don't overtake or, you know, overpower or anything.
You named two or three albums that you thought, as far as you were concerned, that was the absolute master of the producer's art.
Albums that I think are.
Yeah. And it doesn't even matter if you don't like them, it's just where you're sitting there going, that's fantastically produced.
There's a guy called, producer called Garth, with three G's in the start of his name, and he did the first Rage Against the Machine album, and the last three Biffy Clyro albums. He also did one of my all-time favourite two albums, and I think everything he does is just, he never seems to lose it. But my all-time, my favourite producer is a guy called Devin Townsend, and he does like lots of extreme metal and then ambient records and everything in between. It's all very overproduced, but that's, you know, my personal listening, you know, favourite thing. And I always think everything he does is just like, how can he get any better than this? How can he, you know, better than this? How can he get better than this?
I think at the dawn of the hi-fi era, a lot of stuff happened like that, where Tube and a Bell, Dark Side of the Moon. What do you think? Has the production of those stood the test of time, do you think? Or?
For what? Yeah, they do, because of what they had at the time. Obviously, it's very, you know, this is limited, and it's going to get, you know, that's going to be obsolete. There'll be another level that you can go to. At the time, I think it's unbelievable what they did with what they had. You know, you watch these classic album documentaries, you know, the Queen one, for example, which I've seen recently, Unbelievable. Bohemian Rhapsody on 24 tracks. You know, I've seen the multi-track to that, and I've spread it out as if it was done the way I would do it, and it's 74 tracks, and they had 24. It absolutely, you know, like it's mixing those songs would be like learning another language, because you've got to be, you know, when you're mixing it, it's real time, and it must have been, you must have been off your head with craziness. Absolute genius. Mm. Although I think personally, I think there are much better albums of later years for my own taste. But what they did, with, you know, back in the 60s and 70s when things were really progressing with multi-tracking, then these producers should be held up high.
What does success look like for a producer at that level? What would sort of make you dream at home going, I've made it if...
I guess just working on something that gets critical acclaim, you know, that's really kind of well-recepted. You think, oh yeah, okay, cool. Whether it continues or not, I don't know. I mean, I'm in the local scene. I mean, I'm working with some, you know, personally, some of my own favourite musicians currently. You know, bands that I respected when I was a kid. So I'm working on some of their albums now. So you could say, oh, wow, that's fantastic. I you know, that's success. But it could fade out. I'm just day by day. You know, I think as long as I'm working on music and it doesn't matter who it is or what it is and everyone's having a good time, I think that's successful enough.